Howdy folks, I'm fixing to do a video to show, let's just say, a non-technician person how to determine if their charge is low on their cooling system. And I'm going to be showing some pressure readings, but you do not have to have gauges hooked up. This is something you do not need gauges to do. It's done purely visually. And I'm going to repeat myself throughout the video, and you're going to keep hearing me say that you got to start from a known state. And that known state is with the system powered off and no ice on the coils. So what I'm about to show and tell you is not something you can determine by walking up to a machine or a cooling unit that's been running for days and you found it all frozen up. You cannot use this technique like that. That's not correct. You'll have to shut it down, defrost it, and then start it back up and observe what happens during the first 15, 20, 30 minutes after it's been started from a shutdown state. And that's very, very critical. And as you'll see, as I go through the charging of it and running it with low charges, things can get confusing if you don't start from a known state. So let's move on to seeing what this thing will do with virtually no charge, with the minimum charge to get any frost, with about a half a charge, and then with it fully charged. Now this is out of a Coke machine, a Vindo, and it is a fan-cooled or fan-forced evaporator, and it's also a cycle defrost system. So in other words, the cabinet is not maintained below freezing for a continuous time. It's not a freezer, in other words. So we're going to talk about what to look for to determine if it's low on charge or if there's some other thing wrong with it. That seems to be hard for some people, and I'm hoping to help out with that. So what I'm going to do is run it with varying states of low charge, and we'll look at what happens. Now, because this is designed to be in a cabinet, the fan blows air out the back and it recirculates through the evaporator and gets colder and colder each time it passes through. It has to have an enclosure over the evaporator. So in order to know what's happening with the charge level on a machine, a refrigerator, a Coke machine, you must have the door shut. You must be able to shut the door and run it in normal condition before you can tell anything. So I've put this tote on here, and it's smaller than a cabinet, but with no insulation, it lets in a lot of heat and helps to load the machine up a little bit. It will help us to see what's happening inside there. So at this point, this unit has just had some repair work done, and it is very low. It's basically empty. On the low pressure side, we have 5 PSI, which is just some vapor I put in there to keep from running the compressor in a vacuum. So we're going to fire it up and see what it does with it essentially empty. And I do have the thermostat bypassed. So if you look at the low pressure gauge, you see it's pulling down more and more into a vacuum. While that's running, I'm going to explain some of the parts of this that we'll be talking about. This is the condenser coil. That's the coil that's underneath the cabinet that gets hot when the compressor runs. And the condenser coil lets out liquid refrigerant through the filter of some type. It might not be one like that, but there's some kind of a filter. And then it goes into this small capillary tube. That looks like a piece of wire, but it's actually hollow tubing. And the liquid freon is going to go through that tube, and eventually that tube ends up here. And the liquid comes into this coil. And this one we call the evaporator, and that's the coil inside the cabinet that gets cold. So when you hear someone talk about the condenser and the evaporator, that is what they're talking about. Then after it's gone through the evaporator, you have a suction accumulator, which is this piece, before it returns to the compressor. Now, right now, all the fans are running, compressor's running, everything is sounding normal. But if I feel this line right here, there's no cooling at all. This is not, it's actually a tiny bit cooler than the rest of it. but there's no frost, no ice, no water collecting. It's just running, but it's not doing anything. We'll give it another about 5 minutes. Okay, I put the tote over that, and it's been going for about, I would say, 10 minutes. The pressure hasn't moved. Still right where it was. We're at about 10 inches of vacuum. But even without having the gauges hooked up, you'll be able to tell. If we look over here where this capillary tube ends, this is just a tiny bit cool, but there's no frost or any sort of ice on it. So with it totally empty, it runs. There might be a tiny bit of cooling here, but there's no ice buildup. Okay, so I put in a tiny bit more refrigerant. You see it's still in a vacuum. So if we look up here, this capillary tube is covered in ice, and so is the first part of the evaporator. And the ice is stopping right here, but this part is covered in ice. So there's a certain amount of liquid refrigerant in the system that has to go through the condenser and then make it through this capillary tube back to the evaporator. And right now, there's only enough liquid just to reach this point. And all that liquid is boiled off and changed back to vapor just by that point. So that little bit of frost right there, it indicates that there's just a really tiny part of a charge left. And again, I'm gonna let it run for 5 or 10 minutes with the cover on it, and then we'll see what it looks like. All right, been running about 10 minutes with a very, very small charge in it, just the bare minimum to make it frost anything. As you can see, we have a frost line that stops right here. And none of the rest of this coil is cool at all. But if we look down here, the heat exchanger line is sweating. And the reason for that refrigerant is actually boiling in the capillary tube, causing the capillary tube to get cold. So that can be confusing, because an extremely high overcharge can also make this line sweat. But to compare the difference with the extremely tiny charge, you have really hard frost, very, very thick hard frost on a small portion right up here. If it was extremely overcharged, this entire coil would be sweating all the way back to the compressor, but it wouldn't be frosting. So at this point, we can confirm that we have sweat on the capillary tube and a real thick, thick frost just on a small portion of the evaporator. But the charge is just barely enough for it to get any sort of liquid in the system and circulate. So I'm going to shut it down and let that frost melt off, and then I'll put a little more charge in it. So everything's defrosted. I've had it off for maybe 4 or 5 minutes. And if we look at our low side pressure, we're up to about 55 PSI. So there's a lot more pressure in the system. Remember, when we first started, it only had about 5 and it did nothing. Now we're up to 55. So I'm going to start with a totally defrosted coil. We'll fire up the compressor. You see the pressure pulling down. And we'll see what sort of frost line forms on here, how far the frost goes before it stops. Alright, it's stabilized at 10 PSI. And you can see some frost in there. Let me take the cover off. And it's actually cool inside there. So we see now we have this capillary tube goes into this inlet line. That's frosted. And then the first pass of the evaporator here has frost on it. So we're getting further along the system with liquid. We're going to be cooling a little bit now. Like I said, there was some cooling coming from the fan. And if you notice, there's no more sweating here on the return line. So at this point, if you let that run long enough, it would eventually provide some degree of cabinet cooling. But the trouble is, it's harmful to it to run it like that for a long time, because the compressor pumps oil along with the refrigerant vapor. So slowly, all this more or less empty tubing that just has vapor in it will collect a bunch of oil from the compressor. It's not making its way back to the compressor. And these big old compressors have a whole lot of oil reserve, so they're not likely to be damaged. But the newer ones this scenario right here is enough to really kill the compressor eventually, because all this would fill up with oil over time and not get back to the compressor. So this has a little more charge, but not enough to be safe for the system. It's frosting one turn of the evaporator. We don't have any sort of cooling going on in this line at all. It's just ambient temperature. So put a little more gas in there and then defrost it and start it up again. All right, I put in another ounce or two of refrigerant. All the frost is melted off. We're gonna start it up and see what happens again. Low side pulling down. This time I'm gonna cover it up right away. We'll let it run a few minutes and see what happens. All right, you can see the frost just starting to form on the little fitting there at the end of the capillary tube and going around that first inlet line. And over the next couple minutes, we ought to see more of those end turns of the evaporator start frosting up. So now you can see there's three passes of the evaporator that are covered in ice frost, and there's condensation on the outside of the tote, and it's down to like 48 degrees, and it is 85 in this room. So we're actually getting useful cooling at this point. But as you can see, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, there's six more passes or more of the evaporator that aren't getting any cooling action. So at this rate, it would be very inefficient. It would run probably all the time. And eventually, those three passes that are cooling like that would clog up with frost between the cooling fins, and then it would start to build up and clog up the whole coil. So if you defrost it and power it back on, and you see this kind of frost pattern, which is a hard frost on just a few of the coils, then it's low on refrigerant. If you come up to the machine and everything's covered in one big block of ice, you have to defrost it first and start it back up in order to tell what's going on. So this frost pattern here, we've only got enough liquid in the system to make it through those three passes of the evaporator. So let's give it a little bit more refrigerant and see how it looks. So with those three passes frosted, we're looking at a low side pressure of about 18 PSI. In the simulated cabinet, about 42, 43. So now I'm gonna put some more refrigerant in there. All right, put in a little more refrigerant, and then everything's defrosted, warmed up again in the simulated cabinet. So we're gonna go for another start. Low side pulling down there. And I will come back in a few minutes and we'll see if we got frost and what kind of frost pattern. So the first, that inlet tube is starting to frost already. Been probably 30 seconds since I started it. And that first end turn of the evaporator is frosting up already. Give it a few more minutes to stabilize and see what it looks like. So put a little insulation over our imitation cabinet, and you can see there we're already down to like 28 degrees in there. And if I have to vigorously wipe the condensation off the side of this thing, because that's cold enough it just instantly forms again. If you look in there, almost all of the end turns of that evaporator have frost on them. I hope that's coming through on the video. But only maybe the last one and then the outlet line going back to the accumulator now. Maybe those are the only ones that aren't frosted. So it's almost fully charged. It's going to get just a little tiny bit more because I want to see that frost go all the way onto that accumulator. That's what I want to see to know that it's full. We look down at the pressure. We're at about 15 or 16 PSI on the low pressure side. Also, at this point, there's a little bit of sweating on this line, there's no frost. It's not ice cold, but there's a little sweating on the return line. That's just because the return gas is cold enough now. If I move down here closer to the compressor, it's not cold anymore. So we'll put a little more refrigerant in there and we'll see what we get. All right, we're down to about 18 degrees inside the simulated cabinet. You can see, maybe, that there's a light coating of frost on all of the interns in there and on the suction accumulator. But if we come around front, the return line heat exchanger is cool and sweating, but it's not frozen. If I continue back toward the compressor, down around here, it's not cool anymore. It's just ambient temperature. So that, to me, I believe is about the right charge for this. It's working as it's designed. So the thermostat would have cut off below, well before it reached this cold of a temperature. It allowed it to defrost and allowed all the ice to melt off the coils in there. So you can see there's actually a coating of frost on the end of all those fins. And again, I'm sorry about the condensation. So when it's running at these low temperatures, it always gathers ice, but it's supposed to melt off between cycles. I know a lot of people get confused and they think they're low on charge or have too much charge because of where there's frost on the system or where it's freezing up or it's not cooling enough or cooling too much. And the key to being able to tell without cutting into the system and hooking gauges up, the key to being able to tell is to defrost it first and start it and let it run 15 or 20 minutes and then open the door and check and see what the frost pattern looks like after it's just started. Because if anything goes wrong and it overfrosts and starts to clog up the evaporator with ice, you'll never know what actually initiated that problem. If you've let it run for days until something goes wrong, then you have no way to know. So the only way to know if the charge is low based on the frost on the coil is by stopping the machine, letting everything come to room temperature, all the frost to melt, starting it back up again. And then after 15, 20 minutes, or as long as it takes for it to stabilize, you can tell. And another thing, this depends entirely on the evaporator fan working properly and the cabinet door seals, sealing, and if you have any other openings in the cabinet, that they're properly closed and there's not a lot of air infiltrating into the cabinet. And this will let you easily tell whether it's low on charge or not. If your evaporator fan is working normally, and after it runs long enough, you start to see ice forming or frost forming on this return line in spite of everything else working normally, then it is definitely overcharged because there's excess liquid in the system that's coming down and it's boiling off in this line. And if that happens, then you've got an overcharge going on. Another reason that the frost line can come back here and start icing up the return line is if the evaporator fan is not working. That'll make it do that. And again, if the system's been running for days and the coil is clogged with frost and there's no airflow through the evaporator, for any reason, could be the cabinet door didn't close all the way, it could be the thermostat never cycled off due to a problem, for any reason, the evaporator coil inside is totally blocked where no air can flow, it will eventually freeze this line up. So if this line is frozen up down here at the bottom, the return line, don't automatically assume that it's overcharged or undercharged, because you've got to start from a known condition, which would be a standby start, a room temperature start. Give it just long enough to stabilize and then see what's happening. But once it's run for days and something's gone wrong and it's clogged up the coil with ice and continued to run, it will eventually freeze this line up. And you won't know why until you clear it out, thaw all the ice and start over. So I know this video is real, real basic for the refrigeration guys, but it was aimed at the folks who don't actually do this kind of work and just want to have a way to know non-invasively if their charge is low or not. So I hope you guys found this helpful, and if you have any questions, feel free to comment and ask. Thank you so much for watching. Nice old slow speed Tecumseh. It's cold in there.